Good morning. And welcome to Chalice Unitarian Universalist Congregation. We're a liberal, open-minded, open-hearted church. This is a place where you can be exactly who you are and be loved and accepted, where your beliefs may be different than the person next to you, but where we all share the same set of values. This is a place where the mission is to connect, to act and inspire, always with love at the center. Welcome to all. We're glad you're here, newcomers and repeat attenders alike. I'm Alice Dodd, your worship associate today. Our service is led by our minister, Reverend Sharon Wylie. Our worship musician this morning is John Schultz, and our song leader is Jeff Hayes. The tech team is comprised of Hope Campbell and Sarah Komnick. And our greeters for the 11 o'clock are Shannon Anderson and Marshall Fogel. Welcome to our Sunday worship service. In the chapel, you'll notice the windows are open and we have 4 air purifiers going. But if for any reason you want to sit out on the patio, we have speakers out there. Yes. And try staying dry. Those chairs are wet. We're always delighted to see newcomers joining us in worship. And if that applies to you, you might be interested in the groups and activities we have to offer. A good way to get this information is through our email newsletter and monthly e-news calendar. And if you haven't given us your email address when you signed in, please share it with us before you leave. And now let's take a breath together.
Good morning. According to the Library of Congress, the first permanent Euro-American settlements began a pattern of displacement and land appropriation of indigenous people that continued until the 20th century. In this region that we consider home, the Kumeyaay first lived here for over 10,000 years and were the people who greeted the Spanish when they first sailed into the San Diego Harbor in 1542. With this awareness, we acknowledge that Chalice is located on the stolen, tribal, ancestral homeland of the Apai, which is part of the Kumeyaay Nation, and the Payam-Kwechum Nation. This acknowledgement reminds us that we live in a history-driven present and that we need to be intentional with this land and with the people indigenous to the land. Mary Lyons from the Leech Lake Band of Ojibwe states, "When we, the indigenous people, talk about land, land is part of who we are. It is a mixture of our blood, our past, our current, and our future." According to the research done with Reclaiming Native Truth, 40% of Americans do not believe that indigenous people still exist in the U.S. Chalice hopes that with our first step of land acknowledgement, we can move towards educating ourselves and others about indigenous communities and their rich and diverse culture and create a meaningful relationship with them as well.
And now we light our chalice. I'd like to invite Deb Kuhn forward for that honor. Our chalice lighting words come from Dawn Cooley. We light our chalice grateful for the love that we experience in this beloved community. May the flame light the way for all who see such abundance.
Our service today is the first in a series examining the theological teachings in some of our modern TV shows and movies. The words of our call to worship. We come together this morning in friendship, our yearning for connection and invitation to stop and rest and be. We come together this morning in hope, our yearning for a better world, an invitation to gather and dream and act. We come together this morning in love, our yearning for wholeness, an invitation to risk and reach and reveal. Let us worship together. You're invited to rise in body or spirit to join in singing.
Our hymn of the month is number 350 in the gray hymnal, The Ceaseless Flow of Endless Time. We'll sing this hymn at each service this month to help us get to know the hymn and feel more comfortable singing it.
Our Sunday worship is the shared spiritual practice of our community, and we tend to the congregation during this time by sharing and honoring our joys and sorrows. Here in the chapel, you're welcome to write your joy or sorrow on a candle card, which I'll pass out to you in a moment, and collect, and we'll have a few minutes of music so you can write down what you'd like to share. And if you'd like to send Reverend Sharon a confidential note about your joy or sorrow, or to make a prayer request, please email her. And that email address will be on the screen in a moment.
Thank you.
A lovely reminder of how music can stay with us as other things drift away. We light a final candle of a pillar candle for all the joys and sorrows that may go unspoken and unshared this morning. These unshared joys and sorrows are also held in the love and support of our community. Our story is called Have You Filled a Bucket Today? Written by Carol McLeod, illustrated by David Messing. All day long, everyone in the whole wide world walks around carrying an invisible bucket. You can't see it, but it's there. You have a bucket. Each member of your family has a bucket. Your grandparents, friends, and neighbors all have buckets. Everyone carries an invisible bucket. Your bucket has one purpose only. Its purpose is to hold your good thoughts and good feelings about yourself. You feel very happy and good when your bucket is full, and you feel sad and lonely when your bucket is empty. Other people feel the same way too. They're happy when their buckets are full, and they're sad when their buckets are empty. It's great to have a full bucket, and this is how it works. Other people can fill your bucket, and you can fill theirs. You can fill your own bucket too. So, how do you fill a bucket? You fill a bucket when you show love to someone, when you say or do something kind, or even when you give someone a smile. That's being a bucket filler. A bucket filler is a loving, caring person who treats everyone with kindness and respect. When you treat others with kindness and respect, you fill their bucket. But you can also dip into a bucket and take out some good feelings. You dip into a bucket when you make fun of someone, when you say or do mean things, or even when you ignore someone. That's bucket dipping. Bullying is bucket dipping. When you hurt others, you dip into their bucket. You will dip into your own bucket too. Many people who dip have an empty bucket. They may think they can fill their own bucket by dipping into someone else's, but that will never work. You never fill your own bucket when you dip into someone else's. But guess what? When you fill someone's bucket, you fill your own bucket too. You feel good when you help others feel good. All day long, we are either filling up or dipping into each other's buckets by what we say and what we do. Try to fill a bucket and see what happens. You love your family. Why not tell them you love them? You can even tell them why. Your caring words will fill their buckets with joy. Watch for smiles to light up their faces. You will feel like smiling too. A smile is a good clue that you have filled a bucket. If you practice, you'll become a great bucket filler. Just remember that everyone carries an invisible bucket, and think of what you can say or do to fill it. Here are some ideas for you. You could smile and say hi to the bus driver. He has a bucket too. You could invite the new kid at school to play with you. You could write a thank you note to your teacher. You could tell your grandpa that you like spending time with him. There are many ways to fill a bucket. Bucket filling is fun and easy to do. It doesn't matter how young or old you are. It doesn't cost money. It doesn't take much time. And remember, when you fill someone else's bucket, you fill your own bucket too. When you're a bucket filler, you make your home, your school, and your neighborhood better places for all. Bucket filling makes everyone feel good. So, why not decide to be a bucket filler today and every day? Just start each day by saying to yourself, I'm going to do something to fill someone's bucket today. And at the end of each day, ask yourself, did I fill a bucket today? Yes, I did. That's the life of a bucket filler. And that's you. Stories with religious themes have been popular across time, but maybe even more so in recent decades as religion has become less popular and more likely to be criticized. I thought it would be interesting and hopefully fun to lift up to you some shows and movies I think are worth your attention and to reflect on the theology of some of those stories. The word theology, strictly defined, means the study of God, theos, but I think theology is better understood as the study of systems of belief. For example, if you believe that God controls everything, then you must have a corresponding belief that we humans don't have much choice in what happens, because then that would mean that God isn't controlling everything. So those beliefs need to work together. The question of our human free will is an enormous theological question. We'll get to more of that in just a bit, but I wanted to name that it's part of my hope and intention to get us thinking more about the theological ideas we hear and see in some of our favorite stories, especially stories that are interested in theological questions. So the TV show I'm talking about today is called Good Omens. There are two seasons out, and a third and final season will bring the story, we hope and assume, to a conclusion, and should be out in the next couple of years. They just announced the third season was going to happen within the last month. Good Omens is based on a book of the same name, co-written by Neil Gaiman and Terry Pratchett. The full name of the novel is Good Omens: The Nice and Accurate Prophecies of Agnes Nutter, Witch. The book was published in 1990, and the first season of the show came out in May 2019, so almost 30 years later. The book and the TV show can both be described as a comedy about the birth of the son of Satan and the coming of the end times. Classic comedic stories. The two main characters are an angel named Aziraphel and a demon named Crowley. So we're going to watch a trailer for the first season of the TV show.
Aziraphel, it's me. We need to talk.
Yes, I rather think we do.
I assume this is about
Armageddon. Yes.
How long have we been friends? 6,000 years.
Is that you under there, Crowley?
Crowley? What the hell are you playing at?
Friends, we're not friends. We are an angel and a demon. We're on opposite sides.
We're on our side. It's up to me.
Yes.
We have nothing whatsoever in common. I don't even like you.
You do.
Armageddon is coming.
And then it's all over. No more fascinating little restaurants where they know you. No more old bookshops.
There must be some way of stopping it.
We have to work together. Oh, you're my best friend. It's the end of the world we're talking about. It won't be the war to end all wars. with a war to end everything.
We're doomed. Well then, welcome to the end times.
Oh, you're my best friend. Ooh, you make me live.
It's so funny. So I wanted to start just by talking for a minute about how we see theology in stories and how our beliefs can be, I think it's important to be aware of and to think about the things we're seeing and hearing. So I just wanted to walk you through my decision-making first about the children's story and how, you know, how we got to where we were. And that wasn't really a story, right? It was more of a lesson, a teaching. There wasn't a plot with a beginning, a middle, and an end. So when I was thinking about this service and knowing I was going to be talking about this show with angels and demons, I thought, well, let me see if I can find a story for the children about angels. And a bunch of stories came up, and I'm sure if I read them all, I would have found one that was, you know, thoughtful and would work okay with us. But they were mostly about guardian angels. And I actually think that that can be a fairly dangerous theology to teach young children. The idea that there are invisible beings who might keep us from hurting ourselves or send us messages to try and stop us from doing something dangerous might lead people who really believe that into some reckless behavior, assuming that there's a supernatural being who will intervene to help. So, and I didn't imagine that most of our UU parents were doing other teachings about angels and those kind of theologies at home. And so, you know, that puts a lot of pressure on one story to cover a lot of bases about that, those kinds of ideas. So that it just didn't seem to me like that was going to work well for us. So then I moved on to thinking about maybe about decision making and sort of that classic image of an angel on one shoulder and a devil on the other, influencing us one way, helping us or pushing us as we decide things. And so immediately found a lot of children's stories about decision making, very educational, surely written by mental health specialists and early childhood development specialists. And you know, those, they seemed very, you know, educational and maybe even a little preachy, which isn't always what even I want in a story, although we do use some stories like that. And the book I ended up with, it was from one of those lists. But to me, this one jumped out as being like a little less preachy and just a little more charming, and naming something that maybe we already organically feel and giving us a metaphor for understanding what it's like when we're kind and thoughtful to other people, and what it's like if we're not kind and thoughtful to other people. So giving us a metaphor for understanding our interconnectedness and, you know, helping inspire us to some of our best behavior. And so that's how I arrived at that teaching or that lesson for the day. I think that really any belief when taken to an extreme can become harmful or dangerous. And the extreme of that story might be if we started to feel responsible for how other people are feeling and not being able to honor the emotions that people are having. Like, it's okay to feel sad or angry, and we don't want, you know, we don't want to be teaching ourselves that we should rush to make people feel better when they aren't, if they aren't feeling perfectly happy all of the time. So, but in general, you know, I didn't think that that was a story that was going to need too much intervention or sort of teaching of broader ideas in order to help all of us hold that metaphor of the bucket. So that's just sort of a sample of the kinds of things that I think about for all of us. You know, I was talking about the children, but we all need stories that inspire us and help keep us motivated to be our best selves when we might not always be feeling that way. So So the story of Good Omens, I need to start with a couple of caveats. I mentioned the book. I've not read the book. I haven't watched the show more than once. This isn't meant to be like a super deep dive and analysis. This is part of a series that I hope will be lighthearted and fun to get us thinking and talking about the shows and movies we see and what we think of some of the messages in them. So I definitely have experts on Good Omens in the room. And so I just want you to know if you, you know, I don't, yeah. I'm someone who's seen it once. So I'm recommending it to you as something you might enjoy. So we get sort of the central questions of Good Omens in the first few minutes of the first episode of the first season. We open on the Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden and the demon Crowley. So you saw our two main characters are the angel Aziraphale and the demon Crowley. The demon Crowley takes the form of a snake and whispers in Eve's ear, and she picks the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and eats it, shares it with Adam, and then they are expelled from paradise and they leave this beautiful verdant garden into a desert landscape. And then watching them leave, standing on the wall are the angel Aziraphale and the demon Crowley. And Crowley immediately asks the question, you know, does this seem reasonable for God to have put this tree, this fruit tree, in the middle of the garden with a sign that says, don't eat? And does it seem like a proportionate reaction to expel them from paradise for doing what's perfectly, you know, a normal thing to do? And Aziraphale, as we will hear him do again and again in this story, defends God and refers to God's ineffable plan beyond our knowing. We can't understand why God does what God does, but God's ineffable plan is unknowable to us, and it is unable to be articulated. So then Crowley can't help but notice that Aziraphale has traditionally had a flaming sword with him that he doesn't seem to have at this moment of standing on the wall, and asks, where is it? And Aziraphale confides that he gave the flaming sword to Adam because he's so worried about them having to leave the garden and, you know, go out into this harsh landscape, and Eve is expecting a child, so he gave his sword away. But he has been worrying that perhaps that was the wrong thing to do. And Crowley observes, well, you're an angel, it can't have been the wrong thing to do because you're an angel. You can only do good things, which is comforting to Aziraphale to be reminded. And then Crowley wonders if perhaps he did the right thing in tempting Eve to the fruit, because if this is all part of God's ineffable plan, then he must have been doing what he was meant to do. But Aziraphale immediately observes, but you're a demon. You can't have done something according to God's plan because everything you do must be bad. So these are the questions that the whole story will wrestle with in a bunch of different ways. What does it mean if a demon does something good, if an angel does something bad? Do we have free will? Do they have choices to make if everything is unfolding according to a plan that we can't know or understand? One of the other ways that this question gets raised, you heard the subtitle of the book, The Nice and Accurate Prophecies of Agnes Nutter, which Agnes Nutter exists in the 1600s, where she's written incredibly precise prophecies of who will do what and when and what will happen afterwards for centuries to come. And which is another way of raising that question. If the future is knowable in this mysterious way to this person, doesn't that mean that everything is predetermined and that, you know, humans don't really have choices about what they do? So those questions are raised early. In the world of Good Omens, heaven and hell are like these large bureaucratic organizations with invisible CEOs and memos. So the angel gets a memo from home office or writes a memo to home office. The same with the demon and hell writing memos to home office below. Heaven is up, a beautiful office building with completely pristine, no desks, no papers, just just sort of gleamingly clean surfaces and big windows that look out on blue sky, fluffy clouds, and everyone wears white and off-white. And then hell is down. It's the worst basement of the worst office building, crowded with desks and file cabinets. Not enough room for people. The lighting is terrible, and there's insects and reptiles and the demons crowded down there. So in this vision of heaven and hell, God is very distant from the angels. We get to hear a bit of God narrating some of what happens, but we don't get a lot of input and insight from God either. For those of you who are movie fans, God is voiced by Frances McDormand. Yes. Oh, delightful. So even the angels are trying to do God's work, but it's not like they get to go and question God or have meals with God. God is still very much invisible and distant, and you know, angels are trying to do what they think is the right thing. We do get a glimpse of Satan later in the show, but Satan is sort of similar for demons. They're terrified of Satan, and as well as serving Satan. But it's not like Satan is hanging around with demons, and his arrival is, you know, meant to be terrible and terrifying when it happens. So the name of this service in the series is Sermons with Spoilers. But I don't think it's too much of a spoiler. If you know, you've heard, there's a second and third season, to know that the world does not come to an end in season one. You saw in the trailer that sort of the central point of season one is that the son of Satan, the Antichrist, is being born. And everyone in this world, the angels and demons, seem to know and understand the timeline of events that are supposed to occur that will bring about Armageddon, the end of the world, and then a battle between good and evil, demons and angels, which they're all very much looking forward to. They want to get this fight, you know, fight each other and get this all sorted out. But who's not excited about it is Crowley and Aziraphale, who have become very happy and comfortable living on Earth. They're friends, even though they're not supposed to be. Crowley is supposed to be on Earth tempting people to their side. And as a demon, he does some of that, but he also just likes to write memos to home office claiming that he caused something bad to happen. He just sort of, when he sees bad things happening, he says, he caused that traffic jam. He caused that Wi-Fi to go out. And so they think he's doing a great job up here, home office. Aziraphale is supposed to be keeping an eye on him without him knowing, because they're not supposed to be friends. And so heaven, you know, home office thinks he's doing a great job somehow managing to keep an eye on Crowley without alerting him to his presence, when of course these guys have lunch together every couple of days and they enjoy. Aziraphale has a little bookshop he runs. They're pretty happy down here. So when they learn that the Antichrist is coming, that he's been born, and then it's 11 years to his birthday, which should be the big day, they decide to try and find, in their own way, of Aziraphale being an angel and Crowley being a demon, to try and thwart what's going to happen with the Antichrist, because they prefer that Earth and this world just keep going as it always has. They like it down here. So a lot happens. And I noticed, so to prepare for today, I watched, so season one is 6 episodes, which I think is another thing that's great about this series. It's not too long. But I rewatched episode one and the last episode of the first season just to remind myself of some of the stuff. And so I was really reminded of how funny the show is, but also that a lot is happening with a lot of characters. There's a lot to keep track of. As I was talking with someone after the service, it's not a show to have on while you do something else. You need to be giving it some attention. But by the, you know, by the time we get to the end, as I said, Armageddon doesn't come about. And, you know, the semi-spoiler is that it turns out that the son of Satan has free will also. And the fact that he has a destiny doesn't mean that that's something he has to conform to. So he makes a different choice when it's time for him to take sides. And even so, and as I mentioned, the demons and the angels were really looking forward to the war. So they're angry when it doesn't come about. And they're angry with Aziraphel and Crowley for playing a part in keeping Armageddon from happening. So there are repercussions for our heroes that take us into the next season. I didn't watch this show when it first came out. Let me back up to put a pin on season one. As I mentioned, the demons and the angels are angry that Armageddon didn't happen. And part of what they're angry about is they feel that God's plan was thwarted because Armageddon is supposed to happen and they're supposed to fight each other. But Aziraphel raises his same question he always does. If God's plan is ineffable, that means it's unknowable to us. And so if we know this plan, that can't be the plan, because the plan's ineffable. So that question is raised again, and that's a compelling argument, and it doesn't save Crowley and Aziraphel from being viewed as traitors to their side. So again, there are repercussions for both of them. So I didn't watch this show when it first came out, even though I find sometimes that shows and movies that want to, you know, critique religion or work with religious themes aren't always actually that great at it, right? They're in an increasingly secular world, people understand less and less about religion and religious ideas. So those kind of stories aren't always necessarily very compelling. And there are enormous mythologies around angels and demons and hierarchies in heaven and hell and how they interact with each other. So, you know, I worried that it might be a lot of that that I'm not that interested in. So I didn't watch it in 2019. I ended up watching it sometime in the last few months because I got myself on a David Tennant kick. You saw he was the demon Crowley, and I had finally gotten around to watching the second and third seasons of Broadchurch, which is a very serious show that he's in, and he's so good. And so it made me think, like, what else has he been in that I could watch? And then also what we don't see in this trailer is that the angel Gabriel is played by John Hamm, who is an actor I enjoy quite a lot. And he's that character, and he playing that character are featured even more prominently in the second season. So we're seeing these ads for the second season. I thought, oh, okay, maybe I'll watch this now. So that's what tuned me into it. Even still having seen it, I'll say that, you know, I don't struggle with questions of free will and God's ineffable plan. I believe we have free will. I don't believe that, you know, God controls everything and that things we do are predetermined. So the wrestling with it isn't as, you know, interesting to me as it might be. But again, like I said, I rewatched those episodes and was reminded it's a very funny show. It's meant to be a comedy, and it is. And I enjoyed the second season even more. There's just so many parts of it that are hilarious. And it's gotten me thinking, like, maybe I'll watch it again, because I was so busy following the plot. And it's not convoluted, but like I said, it's just a show that needs your full attention. And, you know, we all know shows that don't need your full attention. So this is one you need to be looking at the screen while it's on. What I really like in the second season, I might rewatch it and just enjoy it a little more instead of having to track the plot of what's happening. The second season continues with these questions. Is it okay for an angel and a demon to be friends, for them to like each other? What does it mean if the demon has a spark of good in him? What does it mean if the angel sometimes disobeys God? Raising these questions. The second season includes a flashback to the story of the Book of Job with Crowley and Aziraphel present. And, you know, this is one of the most famous books of the Bible, and really it challenges the idea that we might be suffering or have bad things happen to us because we deserve it. And you can imagine thousands of years ago that that's what people thought. And so a book that gave a different idea that you could be a very good person and still have bad things happen to you was really healing in its way and transformative, and is still a book of the Bible that comforts many people. And many of us have that's a crazy story, right? God allows all of these bad things to happen to Job. And so what really touches me about the telling of it in Good Omens is to see Aziraphel, the angel, you know, God's messenger, God's servant, Aziraphel really struggling with God letting this happen this way. And, you know, what it means to question God, because, you know, what we witness around us can be so terrible. So, you know, for me, that was getting at something I'm more interested in and, you know, more deeply touched by. And that's just, you know, that's just an episode. That's not the story of season two. So I just wanted to lift that up if it's of interest to you. It's on Amazon Prime, which is, you know, a paid channel. So we might not all have access to it. But if you're someone who wants to watch it, you might consider inviting some friends to share your channel and can make it a social a social event. Like I said, it's 6 episodes per season. And then, you know, I don't know yet how the story ends, so can't give you a full review of this story until we see what that third season is about. I hope we get to learn more about God and what God thinks about all of this. So, you know, whatever you take away from this service in terms of wanting to watch or not watch the show, I do hope that you'll bring your theological questions and wondering to every story that you encounter out there. You're invited to rise in body or spirit to join in singing.
Sunday offering is an expression of the generosity that makes congregational life possible. As Buddhist teacher Pema Chodron writes, generosity is an activity that loosens us up by offering whatever we can, a dollar, a flower, a word of encouragement. We're training in letting go. Please text your donation to Chalice. And if you haven't texted a donation before, know that once you text the amount, you'll get a reply with a link to follow to enter your credit card information. But if you've already entered that with a past donation, you won't need to enter it again. And if your Sunday donation is meant to be part of your pledge, please write pledge after the dollar amount. The phone number for text donations will be on the screen in a moment. If you prefer to make an in-person donation of cash or check, there are envelopes to the left of the double doors, and you can leave those donations after the service. Please give generously. Is that the theme music from Good Omens? I've obviously never watched it. Okay. Let's join in dedicating our offering with words of affirmation.
At Chalice UU Congregation, our mission is to connect through worship, music, learning, and caring ministries.
Are broken, out your hand. If your cup be empty, if your cup is full, may it be again. Let it be known. There is a fountain that was not made by the hands of men. There is a road, no simple highway between the dark and the dark of night. And if you go, no one may follow. That path is for your steps alone.
Will you join me in the spirit of prayer? Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the beauty and comfort of our Sunday gathering. We thank you for the many blessings of our community, for people to lean on in hard times, for new people to meet and get to know, for the many different generations here, from our youngest congregants to our eldest, for deep friendships and casual acquaintances, and for the many differences among us that challenge us and keep us growing. We pray for those in our community carrying grief and loss. May they be comforted. We pray for those in our community who may be ill or facing health challenges. May they return to good health. May they have the support of good health care providers. We pray for those who are facing hard times and difficult situations. May they find the strength and clarity to meet these challenges. May they feel the love and support of friends and family. We pray for those who feel lonely and isolated. May they find the determination to reach out to others, and may those around them feel and respond to the pull to reach out as well. Whatever challenges each of us is facing, may we know we are not alone. May we feel the love and support that is around us. And may we find joy and laughter to lift our spirits and keep us moving forward. May it be so. Amen. You're invited again to rise to join in singing.
Sing to my hearts to sing thy grace, strength.
God's perfection fills our hearts with joy and love. Teach us ever to be faithful. May we still thy goodness prove. Come thou fount of every vision, lift our eyes to what may come. See the lion and the young lamb dwell together in thy home. Hear the cries of war fall silent, feel our love glow like the sun. When we all serve one another, then our heaven is begun. Come thou fount of inspiration, turn our lives to higher ways. Lift our gloom and desperation, show the promise of this day. Help us find ourselves in union, help our hands tell of our love. With thine aid, O fount of justice, earth be fair as heaven above.
Our closing words are from Cynthia Landrum. We leave this gathered community, but we don't leave our connection, our concerns, and our care for one another. Our service to each other, to the world, and to our faith continues. Until we're together again, friends, be strong, be well, be true, and loving. Love and blessings to each of you. Blessed be. You're invited to close our time together by singing The Well.
Yes, we drink from the well together. Heart to heart, we are dancing as one. Dancing for justice, dancing for joy. Dance for a love that we are all a part of. We drink from the well, spirits renewed. We drink from the well, stand hand in hand. We drink from the well. Dancing for joy, I feel my heart swell. We drink from the well.
There's coffee and refreshments out on the patio. Thank you for coming.